In an integration services project, the first thing we will do is create a new Dynamics CRM connection. To do this, we can right-click in the Connection Manager's window and select Create New Connection. In the dropdown, we scroll down to find the Dynamics CRM Connection Manager by KingswaySoft. In the first page, General Service Configurations, for the service endpoint, we support both web API and SOAP-based connections. You may select the one appropriate to your environment. For SOAP, we support Active Directory for on-premise, OAuth, and Federation. The OAuth option has additional OAuth types, including authorization code for token-based authentication, client credentials for server-to-server authentication, and certificate. We also support password as well as interactive, which would be helpful at design time. In our example, we will be selecting client credentials. From the app you have created in Azure portal, you may copy the client ID, client secret that was created, and the server URL that we'll be making the service calls to CRM. Select organization will allow you to discover and select from the available organizations in your instance. When you use either authorization code or client credentials, there is an additional feature called user multiplexing available. This feature allows greater throughput by splitting the work across one or more application users in CRM. The benefit is greater performance, more threads can be used in parallel, and less likely for your application user to get throttled. When you open this option, you should see the first connection already available, and you can just click on the plus sign and add the client ID and secret for the other application users. Note the populated fields have been taken from the previous page. You may authorize a write from our component if it has not been granted already within the app permissions in Azure portal. In the second page, proxy server, if you have a proxy on your server, you may include these here, either by auto-detecting a system-configured one or manually entering the proxy, including the server, port, and username and password if applicable. If we go into the third page, advanced settings, this is where we can configure a few additional settings. If your instance requires a home-realm URI, you may optionally specify the URI of the cross-realm STS metadata endpoint. The second option, retry on intermittent error, when enabled, this will allow our component to retry if it detects a brief intermittent error may have occurred, and this may help in cases where more than one attempt can cause success rather than fail the execution. The time zone conversion engine dropdown, you may select if your time zone has a requirement for modern or legacy conversion. By default, you will see this set to automatic or auto. For custom headers, this would only be available for web API, but you may specify any headers by clicking the plus sign to provide a header and the value. Once ready, we recommend testing the connection. If successful, you may click OK to save your current configuration. Once you have the connection manager configured, for reading data from CRM instance, you may select the Dynamics CRM source component from the dropdown in SSIS Toolbox. When we open, it takes us to the general page. First, we can select the connection manager we created before. The source type shows us the available options we may select. For entity, you may select this for working with a specific entity. For fetch XML, you can use this to, if you have a fetch XML query, to customize the data retrieved in more complex use cases. The next option, entity changes, utilizes the change tracking feature to track transactional changes in an entity. This will include an input and output token and will only affect the fields that have changed since the last run. The next option, audit logs, would be for audits and audit details for the audit you have entered in your fetch XML query. Metadata is to extract the metadata from a system, so it'd be the entity field, the lookup, or the option set. In our example, we select entity, and we select the source entity we want to work with. The batch size lets you control how many records are read in a single call, and the max rows returned will only return that value set. By default, it's set to 0, which means return all. The impersonate as is an optional field you may set to specify the CRM user to impersonate when reading data from the available dropdown. For output time zone, the default is UTC, but you may also select adjust to the connection user, which will adjust to the connection user's time zone, or adjust to the impersonation user. Once we have this configured, the columns page will populate with the CRM fields available for that entity. In the Find text box, you may filter to find a specific fields or number of fields. The first column, you may control which fields to select unselect for the downstream path. The topmost select will either select all or deselect all fields. The second column that we see is the name of the field. The third column is the data type associated with the CRM field. The hide unselected option lets you quickly look at just the selected fields. Going back to the general page, if we select the source type FetchXML, we can provide a FetchXML query. Also, with just a few clicks, you may convert your SQL query into a FetchXML query right within our component. You may open the window, paste your query, and select Convert. When you click OK, this will save your FetchXML query. As you can see, you may also include variables in your FetchXML query for dynamically setting those values. In a data flow, we begin with some test data, so we may write to our CRM environment. We can drag and drop our component into the window and connect the source to the destination. When we open the CRM destination component, within a general page, you may select the connection manager or create a new one. Next, we will select the action to perform. There are a few options to choose from. When we select the create option, this would be used to create new records. When we select update, this would be to update existing records. And when delete is selected, this would delete existing records. For the upsert action, we will look for a matching record to update, and if not found, it will create a new record instead. For the merge action, this works with either the account entity, contact entity, leads, or incident entity to merge a pair of records. This is helpful when there are duplicate values and they have different fields populated. This will sync them into one single record. The convert action would be used when we want to qualify a lead, turn an opportunity into a quote into a sales order, or a sales order into an invoice. For the send action, this would be selected when we need to send a CRM email for each incoming record. For the execute workflow action, you may select a workflow action that is either global or entity specific. There are some additional options made available, and we will highlight those later in the video. The bulk delete action would submit a bulk delete job that will delete records in bulk. The benefit is that it runs in the background asynchronously, so other activities would not be blocked. For the calculate rollup fields, this would be used to force the calculation of CRM rollup fields. And lastly, for revise quote, this would be used for revising quotes. The destination entity will be the entity that we write to in Dynamics. For our example, we will be selecting the account entity. Under the record matching and related optimizations, the record matching criteria may be selected from the dropdown. Please note that this is only available for update, which determines how to find the matched records in CRM to perform the update, and upsert action, which would be used to determine if this is a new record or an existing one to be updated. The primary key will use the entity's primary key and input value to match records. The system duplicate detection will use CRM's duplicate detection rules defined in the system to match records we are writing against the target system. Manually specify option will allow you to select under the columns page the field or fields to use for record matching. You will see one additional column in the columns page that you can adjust. Alternate key. System defined alternate key. An alternate key option will be specified. When you select a record matching criteria of either manually specify or alternate key, the dropdown of how to handle multiple matches becomes available. The options available are update all rows, update one row, ignore multiple matches, or raise an error. If your source data contains duplicates based on the key field selected, there are three options available to work with. The icon provides more details and can be used as a reference. By default, no optimization is selected. This would be a recommended option if you know that there are no duplicates from the source system. The other option, write first records only. If there are known duplicates from source and your requirement is just to write the first record, any other duplicates would be skipped. Please note that these records will be available in the skipped rows output. The last option, write all with no duplicate creation. If you need to write all rows to the target system, if the first record is a new record, it will be created and the other duplicates will be performed as an update. On the right side, there are optional settings that you may enable. Send datetime values in UTC format will ensure that the datetime values will be sent to the target system in UTC format. Ignore unchanged fields allows you to ignore any fields that have not been changed in a target CRM system. All unchanged fields will be skipped and not posted to CRM. Ignore null valued fields allows you to ignore any fields that have a null value. This can help avoid a scenario when a field has a value and may be overwritten with an empty value instead. Remove invalid characters. This will remove any invalid characters to help avoid XML exceptions when our component constructs the SOAP request to the CRM server. Remove unresolvable references. When performing CRM lookup and refers to a field that does not exist in the system, the lookup field will be removed before data is written. Enable system duplicate detection. uses CRM duplicate detection rules to find a system to match records against the target system. And lastly, the change flag fields becomes available when we enable ignore unchanged fields option, and it is helpful if tracking is needed where the last change was initiated for a record. You may set a string value for a change flag field. Next, we are going to go over the multi-threading and batch settings. The batch provided would determine the number of records sent in a single call. The appropriate size would be determined by the entity and the fields being written. For larger data types or more fields, a lower batch size may be recommended. You may enable the homogeneous batch operation messages for more efficient batch writing, and this would utilize the create multiple, update multiple, and delete multiple feature. When you enable multi-threading writing, you may select the number of threads that will be working in parallel. With the current settings we have as an example, each batch will contain 50 records when writing to the target system and a thread count of 40. This would mean 40 calls are being sent in parallel, and this would result in 2,000 rows being processed. This would continue until all rows have been written to your destination. In the second page columns, this is where we can map our fields from our source to the target field available in the destination. To the right, you can see details of the target field, such as the data type, whether the field can be created or updated, and we can also quickly unmap by clicking the unmap icon for the field, and this will set it back to ignore. If there's a field you would like to search, you may enter it or partially enter it, and this will filter for just the matched fields. For option set fields, you may go to the option value mapping editor page by clicking the ellipses. Within this window, you may have your input values mapped to a Dynamics option set value. In the target option value, this will provide the available options for the field. We can create a new mapping by clicking the plus icon. The input value will be a text where you may enter a value. You can create a mapping for a target option value as needed. In our example, we map to all four available fields. There are a few options you may choose from for working with non-matched values. If another option is needed for the set, you may choose and create another option. If no match is found, you may replace as an existing option as the new default. For the option set is empty, when no matches are found, you may set it as an empty or null. For the option leave it as is, this allows you to pass through the input value without making any changes when no match is found. And lastly, raise an error. For an input when no match is found, it would throw an exception. For unique identifiers or otherwise GUIDs, target fields, such as created by, the text lookup will be made available. To open the text lookup editor window, click the ellipses. By default, the do not use text lookup will be selected, and you may keep this option if the value in your input field is a GUID. If the field's values from the source is not a GUID, you may perform a text lookup and retrieve the value from the target entity you are looking at. If the primary field is selected, this will use the primary field of the entity. Or you may select your own target fields for the lookup. The list of target entities will be made available for both options. In our example, we will be choosing our own target field, which makes some additional drop-down options available. For the lookup method, primary field will use the primary field of the entity. Alternatively, if you have configured in the General tab the record matching criteria, you may select the manually specify or alternate key option. For opt-out, this may be selected if the input is a GUID value. And lastly, nullify input values would not perform lookup for this target entity, and the value would be skipped. You may select the target field of the target entity. This may be either a text or an integer field. For example, if we select fullname field in the target entity system user, the input field we mapped in the columns page would perform a lookup and return a GUID value. There are some additional options you may also select. The write null or empty values. Null will be written to the empty values. For smart name match option, this can be selected for names in a specific format. There's a note at the bottom of the page of the allowed formats. For the exclude inactive options, this would exclude inactive records. And lastly, the optional default value would set a default string value when no match is found. To help with the navigation, you may select either of the two options, hide unmapped fields or hide mapped fields. This would help by filtering for only either the unmapped fields or just the mapped fields. We can see the fields already mapped, and in the first column, we can set which we would like to be, the key or the key fields. The last page, error handling, lets us choose how to handle when an error is thrown. By default, the component is set to fail on error. The second option, redirect rows to error output, would divert the rows that have errored into a separate path. We can see this path by connecting another component. In our example, we select dummy destination, which is a placeholder destination, which will accept all rows. The red path is for the redirected rows. To show the additional columns provided, we can enable a data viewer and open up the path editor. On the data viewer page, we can see additional columns, such as error code, error columns, error message, as well as the original columns for our data. The error columns may be used to check why an error has occurred for a particular row when written to a destination such as an SQL table or a flat file. Going back to the general page for the action Execute Workflow action, when selected would allow you to execute any workflows you have created in Dynamics or the standard pre-existing ones. When no destination is selected from the dropdown, this would only show the global workflows available to you. You may also choose a specific entity, which will give you the workflows for that entity only. The last section, Process Optimization, lets you bypass business logic, workflows, or entity auditing during execution. You'd find this helpful as the bypass only temporarily occurs when writing and is re-enabled afterwards. There would be no need to go into the system directly and disable these plugins or workflows, and they would be available for other processes that would require them. When we open the dropdown for bypass business logic executions, there will be two options you may enable, custom async and custom sync. When one or both are selected, this would bypass the synchronous or asynchronous plugins or workflows while the component is writing to the service. You may see additional details when you click the eye icon that may be helpful with how to work with these options and the functionality of each. Once you are happy with the configuration, you may press OK to save the changes and close the component. Thanks for watching, and we hope this video has been helpful when working with our Dynamics CRM components. KingswaySoft, data integration made easy.